whatever bony pelvis kept on your table is not the original one, correct? So it is all plastic one, okay? And I have given the first line about the bony pelvis, the point between, difference between the bony pelvis of the male and that of the female, which is very important when you go to the final year, mainly in obstetric and gynecology. They will ask you the difference between the bony pelvis of the male and that of the bony pelvis of the female. If you read with this, you cannot make out anything. Okay? Try to get that maybe one or two original human bony pelvis. Try to see the features in that. Because here, bony pelvis, whatever we say or so-called male and female, weight will be same because both are plastic. Features will be same because both are plastic. Clear? Bony pelvis in case of males, it is heavier. Bony pelvis of the male, it is heavier. The features are more prominent in the bony pelvis of the male. Is that clear? When compared to that of the female. So please read all the differences between male and female bony pelvis. Subpubic angle, the greater sciatic notch, the foramen, operator foramen, okay, subpubic angle, ischial tuberosity, is it clear? Ischial tuberosity ramus, all these things you have to see, the difference between that of the male and female bony pelvis. So if anybody asks what is this, you cannot say pelvis, you have to say bony pelvis. Please remember that. Pelvis is different, bony pelvis is different. Is it clear? Then they may ask you in the OBG, obstetric and gynecology, they may ask you to hold it in an anatomical position. Keep the articulated bony pelvis against the vertical plane. When you hold it against the vertical plane, you can see anterior superior spine and pubic tubercle will be touching the vertical plane. Okay? They should be same in the same vertical plane. So that is the anatomical position of the bony pelvis. Anterior superior iliac spine and pubic tubercle should touch the same vertical plane. Is that clear? That's clear. So please remember that. Then all the diameters are more in females when compared to males. The pelvic cavity is deep in case of males, less deep in case of females. Please see all the features. Okay. That is one thing. Second thing, they will ask you when there is complication in relation to the delivery, normal delivery, okay, they will ask what type of bony pelvis this female is having. Okay, there are different types of bony pelvis. They will ask you what are the different types. Is it clear? What are the different types? Four types? Gynecoid, antroid, anthropoid, platypilloid. Okay, please remember the different types of bony pelvis. That's clear? And look at the size of the acetabular fossa in male as well as in case of female. So all those features you have to read. That is important for you for your future. That is mainly in relation to the gynecology. Okay, when you go to gynec department, they will ask you. Then the femur. The femur is the longest bone in the body, longest bone, maybe 45 centimeters in length, like that of the spinal cord and vasteferens. Sartorius, 45 centimeters, nothing more. Maybe 45 centimeters, sartorius, the femur, around 45 centimeters. Okay? Not exactly, around 45 centimeters. Spinal cord, vasteferens, all having the almost same length. Okay? When you hold the femur in anatomical position, you have to look for the upper end and lower end. In the upper end, you can see the head of the femur, which is rounded. It is an example for pressure epiphysis. a lateral to the head, we have greater trochanter, lesser greater trochanter, and lesser trochanter. Great, this is the lesser trochanter, that is the greater trochanter. Example for traction epiphysis. Okay, so you should remember the attachment to the greater trochanter, attachment to the lesser trochanter. Okay, and here is the trochanteric fossa. That also you have tricuspid tendon, you have to remember. And this is the, this one is the shaft. Here you can see the gluteal fibrosity, where gluteus maximus muscle is attached. And this is the linea aspera, please read that. Medial and lateral supraponal are lined, and below there is a rectal tubercle. Rectal tubercle. I have not given the explanation because you people will tell already slide, number of slides are more. That's why I thought let me not give. You only read from the book, then only you will realize how difficult it is to get the material from different sources. When I give, you will count the number of the slide rather than the content. Okay, number of slides and pictures you will not consider, you will count the number of slides. Correct? So that's why I thought let me leave at least osteology part to yourself so that you can read from different books. Okay? Now, when you hold it in anatomical position, how will you hold it in anatomical position? When you hold it in anatomical position, the femur stands like this. This is the anatomical position. In the index finger, keep your index finger below the head. Junction between the head and neck of the femur, keep your index finger. Okay? You can hold the femur like this. This is how it is located or situated in the body. That's clear? Okay? And if you see that the femur is convex forward, the shaft of the femur, is convex forwards. Okay? So when you hold, if you hold with the left, I mean right hand, right index finger, it is convex backwards now. Correct? It should be convex forwards. Head facing medially, convexity forwards. That's clear? And adductor tubercle on the lower end or the medial aspect, posterior medial aspect. Okay. The shaft of the femur, why it is convex? When the child is born at birth, the shaft is almost straight, When the child starts crawling and standing, walking, running, the convexity becomes slightly more and more. Because of the transmission of the weight from the upper part of the body or trunk and head and neck, it is transmitted to the ground via the lower limb, via the femur. So when the transmission of weight takes place, the femur slightly bent forward because it is not fully ossified, it is cartilaginous. That's why it bent forward. Is that clear? Okay, please remember, that's why convexity forwards. Specialized, I mean, DM orthopedics, they may ask. Okay. So that is about the shaft. The attachment of the muscles, please see the picture one, the picture which I gave, and read from the book. This is the fovea cavitis of the ligament of the end of the femur. Okay, this end of the femur. Lesser trochanter, greater trochanter, I said already. So please read about the femur. Then patella. That's the patella. This is the apex of the patella. This is the base of the patella. This is the base. That is the apex. Apex is directed forward. Can you make out? No? You can make out now. This is the apex directed forwards or downwards, and this is the base directed upwards. This is the anterior surface. So this is the apex. This is the base. Okay? This is the posterior surface. Can you see the two facets in the posterior surface? This is the larger lateral facet, smaller medial facet. smaller medial fascia, larger lateral fascia. Okay? So when you keep the patella on the horizontal surface, it sits on the lateral larger fascia. Sits on the lateral larger fascia. So whichever side it sits, that is the lateral larger fascia. Accordingly, you have to identify the side of the patella. So it is sitting laterally. This is the medial fascia, so this is of the left side. Suppose if it stands like this, if it sits like this, here this is the medial fascia, this side is the lateral fascia. So this is on the right side, then it becomes the right side. But it is not so, it is sitting like this, larger lateral fascia, so this is of the left side. Okay? It's happening for the second time. Okay, can you hear? No? Okay. Larger lateral facet and smaller medial facet. Is it clear? Now, the patella is the largest sesamoid bone in the body. Wherever tendon gets the friction, where the tendon is under friction, in that region the tendon tends to develop sesamoid bone. In that region, sesamoid bone will develop in that tendon. In other words, sesamoid bones are tendinous in origin, develop in a tendon. No periosteum, no medullary cavity, no primary center of ossification, no Haverstein system, no nutrient foramen. Clear? They develop secondarily or after birth by secondary center of ossification. Please remember, largest sesamoid bone is the patella. There are many sesamoid bones. Most of them are not named. Only few are named, like the kneecap or the patella, rider's bone, fibula. Okay? So some of the bones which we are going to come across later. Okay. Pisiform bone you have studied already. Pisiform bone. That's a sesamoid bone developing the tendon of. Flexor carpi ulnaris. Flexor carpi ulnaris develops in the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. Okay. So that is pisiform bone. Now, next is model. This one is important because I can ask a couple of questions from this, because there are two models. This one is the inguinal, this is the inguinal ligament, that's the inguinal ligament. This one is the inguinal ligament, can you see that? That's the inguinal ligament. This is the femoral nerve, that's the femoral nerve. That's the lateral cuneus nerve of the thigh, this is the obturator nerve. Obturator nerve, can you see that? Obturator nerve, this one is the femoral nerve, that is the lateral cuneus nerve of the thigh, this is the inguinal ligament, behind is the sciatic nerve. Clear? So that is important. Next, coming to the femoral triangle. Femoral triangle, now this is the front of the thigh, that's the front of the thigh, this is the rectal compartment, this is the back of the thigh, and here is the gluteal region. Now in the upper part of the front of the thigh, you will see the femoral triangle. The femoral triangle, base is formed by the inguinal ligament, laterally it is bounded by medial border of sartorius. Medially it is bounded by medial border of adductor longus. Apex is formed by overlapping of medial and lateral boundaries. Roof, it is formed by skin, superficial fascia of these contents, and fascia lata. Now, fascia lata is nothing but the deep fascia of the thigh, which shows two important features. One is cavernous opening, which you cannot see here. Another is iliotibial tract. Iliotibial tract is the thickening of the fascia lata on the lateral aspect of the thigh. So this is the iliotibial tract. On the lateral aspect of the thigh, the iliotibial, fascia lata is thickened to form the iliotibial tract. This iliotibial tract, I said, can be asked for the squatters because it serves for the attachment of two muscles, tensor fascia lata and gluteus maximus. Okay? And this iliotibial tract below, if you trace it, it is attached to the lateral condyle of the tibia, and if you trace it above, it splits into superficial lamina and deep lamina. Inside is deep lamina, and here this is the superficial lamina. Superficial lamina is attached with the tubercle in the outer lip of the iliac crest, and deep lamina is blending with the capsular ligament of the hip joint. Now, if you see here, same thing, iliotibial tract, which is cut, you can see the muscle inside the iliotibial tract. I said it splits to enclose the muscle. There is the tensor fascia lata. This one is the tensor fascia lata. And behind, it's also the attachment of gluteus maximus. See, this is the gluteus maximus. Which is attached to the iliotibial tract, gluteus maximus muscle. It is attached to the iliotibial tract. Tensor fascia lata is attached to the iliotibial tract. Clear? That's clear. Okay. Now, coming to the contents of the, contents and floor of the femoral triangle. The floor of the femoral triangle, it is formed by a rectus longus, pectineus. This is the pectineus. Okay. This is the iliacus muscle. That's iliacus, lateral femoral nerve. And behind the femoral nerve and medial to femoral nerve is the psoas major. In other words, femoral nerve lies in the iliopsoas groove. So that is the femoral nerve. Now, femoral nerve can be tied, identify the type structure, femoral nerve, mention its root value, specific root value. So it originates from dorsal division of ventral rami of second, third, and fourth lumbar spinal nerves. Okay? Identify the type structure specifically. Trunk of the femoral nerve. Mention its motor nerves, motor branches. Mention its means trunk of the femoral nerve supplies only two muscles, iliacus and pectineus. Trunk of the femoral nerve. Yeah? Then it divides into anterior division and posterior division. Anterior division, it is partly motor, mainly sensory. Supplies the sartorius and two sensory branches, medial and intermediate cutaneous nerves. The posterior division of the femoral nerve is mainly motor, partly sensory, motor branches supply the rectus femoris, vastus medialis, vastus intermedius, vastus lateralis. The sensory branch is the saphenous nerve. Here, so that one, you have to remember that division of the femoral nerve or trunk of the femoral nerve. Which portion is R? You have to read properly. Okay. Then, femoral artery. This is a femoral artery, direct continuation of the external iliac artery from the midinguinal pons. So, I told in the class, you should remember the surface marking of the femoral artery, since it is very important when you go to the clinic, they will ask you the surface marking of the femoral artery or to pass intravenous injection to the femoral vein or to give the femoral nerve block, they will ask the femoral nerve. So if you know the surface marking of the femoral artery, fingerprint to the medial is the main, fingerprint to the lateral is the femoral nerve. You can feel the pulsation of the femoral artery. One fingerprint lateral to the pulsation is the femoral nerve, one fingerprint medial to the pulsation is the femoral vein. So please remember how to mark the femoral artery on the surface. You have to abduct the thigh, and laterally rotate the thigh. Connect the midinguinal point to the tubercle. adductor tubercles. Upper two-thirds of the line corresponds to the femoral artery, upper two-thirds. Please remember that for your future. Please remember. The femoral artery, femoral vein are covered by the femoral sheath. I said already, bronchial fascia transversalis and fascia iliaca, anterior wall is fascia transversalis, posterior wall is bronchial fascia iliaca. The femoral artery gives three superficial and three deep branches. You have to remember the superficial branch and deep branch. Superficial circumference iliac, superficial epigastric, superficial external pudendal. Deep branches, deep external pudendal, profunda, femoris artery, and muscular branches. Muscular branches. Please remember that. Here, the femoral vein, we have to remember, I said in pediatric cases, you have to remember the femoral vein, which is the main vein which is used for intravenous injection. Here, and the main tributary of the femoral vein is the great saphenous vein. So, great saphenous vein can be asked for the spotters, identify the type structure, great saphenous vein, mention its formation. It is formed on the dorsal of the foot by the joining of medial marginal vein with the medial end of the dorsal venous arch. Medial end of the dorsal venous arch unites with the medial marginal vein to form the great saphenous vein. And great saphenous vein terminates by opening into the femoral vein by piercing the piriform fascia, passing through the saphenous opening, opens into the femoral vein. The tributaries of great saphenous vein can be asked. The tributaries correspond to the superficial branches of femoral artery. That is superficial circumference iliac vein, superficial epigastric vein, superficial external pudendal vein. It also receives deep external pudendal vein. Other branches, I said, it may become difficult for you to remember. They are the veins which connect the superficial veins and with the deep veins of the lower limb. Any valve incompetency or failure of this valve results in varicosity or varicose veins in the lower limb. Please remember that so that it builds up the vein. So that is about the context. Deep femoral group of lymph nodes you cannot see because it is remote. Femoral branch of the genital femoral nerve you cannot see, it is small branch. Okay, it's small branch. Other cutaneous nodes are not traced in this. It is not there in this. Okay, maybe in some of the jars it may be there. Now coming to the muscle. This is the sartorius muscle. It's also called as Taylor's muscle. Taylor's, longest muscle. When we say longest muscle, it has got one point of origin and one point of insertion. In that way, this is the longest muscle, not erector spinae. Otherwise, erector spinae is the longest muscle. But here, attachment origin is at one point, insertion is at another point. Okay? So that's why it's the longest muscle. Or it's also called as Taylor's muscle. Then, this one. So this is sartorius muscle, I said. Sartorius, you can see it is quite long. See, from here till here, longest muscle. Okay? And lateral to that, this is the rectus femoris. Rectus means straight. Lying in front of the femur, straight. So there is a rectus femoris. Consists of two heads, reflected head and straight head. Two heads of origin. Okay? And lateral to the rectus femoris is rectus lateralis. Medial to the rectus femoris is rectus medialis. I said we should look into the lower fibers of the rectus medialis, which are horizontal, prevent the lateral dislocation of the patella by the contraction. Here, so there is the horizontal fibers of the rectus medialis, this is the rectus lateralis, this one is the rectus femoris, behind the rectus femoris is the rectus intermedius. That's the rectus intermedius. Somewhat archaeotic, but if you separate the apparent oxygen, you can see deep that is the muscle. Yeah? So, together, all these muscles together called as quadriceps femoris. Rectus femoris with the vascular muscles together called as quadriceps femoris. Quadriceps femoris. And developing the tendon of quadriceps femoris, we have the kneecap or patella. The distal part of the tendon of quadriceps femoris degenerates. And form the ligamentum patellae. So that is the ligamentum patellae. That's the ligamentum patellae. Degenerated and devoted part of the tendon of quadriceps femoris looks passing through, it is extending from patella to the tibial tuberosity. But patella develops in the tendon of cordyceps involved. Patella develops in the tendon of cordyceps involved. If you look at the, if you feel the kneecap region in the just born child, you will not see anything. Just tendon only. Later, the patella develops. Okay? So that is the muscle of the plexus and the external compartment. In the adductor compartment, you will see gracilis. This is the gracilis muscle. Gracilis, subcutaneous marginalitis. This one is the adductor longus. Adductor longus. This is the pectineus. This is the pectineus. Behind the adductor longus, this is the adductor brevis. Adductor brevis in the upper part. Adductor minus in the lower part. Adductor minus. This whole thing is adductor minus. This is adductor brevis. This is adductor longus. Yeah. Okay. So please remember all these muscles. All the muscles of the adductor compartment are sometimes like obturator nerve. Root value is ventral division of ventrorami of second, third, and fourth lumbar spinal nerves. Lumbar spinal nerves. So that is about the adductor compartment. Now coming to the hamstring compartment and gluteal region. Now this is the gluteal region. This is the gluteal region. Can you see that? That's the gluteal region. Now, gluteus maximus is cut and exposed. These sectors are exposed. Gluteus maximus is cut, which is part, is removed, and other sectors are exposed. But yeah, now what are the other sectors you see? Gluteus maximus can be asked for the problems. Identify the pain sector, gluteus maximus, give it nerve supply and action. It is the chief extensor of the hip joint. Chief extensor of the hip joint. Supplied by inferior gluteal nerve. Inferior gluteal nerve. So deep to that is the gluteus medius. This is the gluteus medius. Deep to the gluteus medius, that's the gluteus minimus. Gluteus minimus. Gluteus minimus. And between the medius and minimus, you can see here along the upper corner of the piriformis. This is the piriformis. This is the piriformis. Along the upper corner of the piriformis, you can see superior gluteal nerve and vessel. Right. So this is the superior gluteal nerve, superior gluteal artery, superior gluteal vessels. You can see above the piriformis, deep to the gluteus medius and minimus. I told in the class, gluteus medius and minimus are important for their action and nerve supply. Suppose if I tie the superior gluteal nerve, identify the tie structure, superior gluteal nerve. Give it motor distribution, or mention it, give it distribution. Okay, motor distribution, it supplies gluteus medius, it supplies gluteus minimus, it supplies tensor fascia latae. And it gives the articular branch to the hip joint. Is it clear? Now, gluteus medius and minimus, if they are paralyzed, leads to a condition called as Krendelberg sign, positive Krendelberg sign. Again, if the gluteus medius and minimus of one side is paralyzed, the person, suppose left side it is paralyzed, right side it is normal, right side it is normal. And if you ask the patient to stand on the right foot, he can stand and clear the left foot off the ground. But if you ask the patient to stand on the affected knee, he will dip onto the normal limb. That is called as dipping gait or lurching gait. Tipping gait or lurching gait. If both muscles are paralyzed, both side muscles are paralyzed, leads to waddling gait, waddling gait. Now, you have to remember, when the gluteus medius and minimus of one side are normal, they will pull the pelvis of that half down. So, opposite half of the pelvis is tilted upward, so that we can clear the opposite limb off the ground, opposite foot off the ground. Is it clear? Please remember that. So that is about gluteus medius and minimus. Now, piriformis. This is the piriformis. It takes origin from, this one is the piriformis. It takes origin from pelvic surface of the sacrum. Pelvic surface of the sacrum in the pelvic cavity. Comes out of the pelvic cavity by passing through the greater sciatic foramen. The greater sciatic notch. This is the greater sciatic notch. This is the greater sciatic notch. Which is converted into prefrontal foramen by sacrotuberous and sacrospinous ligament. Sacrotuberous and sacrospinous ligament convert a notch into foramen. This foramen, great ascending foramen, is almost completely occupied by the piriformis muscle. Whatever space above the piriformis or below the piriformis transmits the structures from the pelvic cavity to the gluteal region. In other words, structures entering the gluteal region or coming to the gluteal region, they are related to the piriformis. Hence, the piriformis is called as key muscle of the gluteal region. Key muscle, main muscle of the gluteal region. Above the piriformis, we have superior gluteal nerve and vessel. Below the piriformis, we have inferior gluteal nerve and vessels, sciatic nerve, posterior cutaneous nerve of the thigh, perforating cutaneous branches, nerve to quadratus femoris, pudendal nerve, internal pudendal vessels, nerve to operator internals, pin structures. So all these structures, they pass below the piriformis through the greater sciatic foramen. So please remember all those structures passing above the piriformis and below the piriformis. But here I can just show a couple of structures. This is a piriformis. Above the piriformis, we have superior gluteal nerve and vessel. Superior gluteal nerve and vessel above the piriformis. Below the piriformis, you can see here inferior gluteal nerve and vessel, sciatic nerve only. Sciatic nerve, inferior gluteal nerve and vessel. Other structures are not seen. Okay. Then the sciatic nerve, this is the sciatic nerve. This is the thickest nerve in the body. Okay? And it originates from the sacral plexus, enters the gluteal region by passing through the greater sciatic foramen below the piriformis, and lies on the short lateral rotators. Now, what are the short lateral rotators from which it lies? Here you can see gamulus superior muscle. That's the gamulus superior. This is the gamulus inferior muscle. Between the two is the tendon of operator internus. Operator internus, gamulus superior, gamulus inferior muscle. Quadratus femoris muscle. And along the lower part of the gluteus maximus, it enters the back of the thigh. Runs in the back of the thigh at the junction between upper two-thirds and lower one-third of the thigh, back of the thigh. It terminates by dividing into medial, tibial nerve, lateral common peroneal nerve. This is a common peroneal nerve, that is a tibial nerve, and this is a sinus nerve. Yeah? In its course, in the back of the thigh, it gives branches along its medial border. This is the lateral border of the sciatic nerve, this is the medial border. You can see all the branches are coming from the medial border, around the medial border, which supply the hamstring muscles of the thigh. Okay, so that's about the sciatic nerve and this structure. If you see the same structures in this plastinated specimen in the gluteal region, this is the gluteus maximus, this is the gluteus maximus muscle, this is the gluteus medius muscle, this is the gluteus minimus muscle, and here you can see superior gluteal nerve and vessel, superior gluteal nerve and vessel, this is the piriformis, that's the piriformis, this is the sciatic nerve, below the piriformis, we have gamulus superior, which is not that clear, gamulus superior, that is the gamulus inferior, and this one is the quadratus femoris. Okay? And this is the inferior gluteal nerve and vessel. Okay, so that's about the plastinated specimen. So gluteus maximus, gluteus medius, gluteus minimus, piriformis, gamulus superior, gamulus inferior, quadratus femoris, this is the quadratus femoris, and this is the sciatic nerve, superior gluteal nerve and vessel, inferior gluteal nerve and vessel.
I think in that one, you can see the pin structures. In that plastinated specimen, you can see the pin structures.
Okay. Then, hamstring compartment. This is the hamstring compartment. What are the hamstring muscles? Hamstring muscles include long head of the biceps femoris. This is the long head of the biceps femoris. Long head. Okay? Semitendinosus. Adductor magnus.
electron magnets.
Now, let me tell the features of hamstring muscle. To call these muscles as hamstring muscle, one, they should take origin from ischial tuberosity. Now, this is ischial tuberosity, that is ischial tuberosity. So, all these muscles are taking origin from the ischial tuberosity. Ischial tuberosity is the one on which you will be sitting. Okay? So, this is the ischial tuberosity. That's ischial tuberosity. Okay? That's ischial tuberosity. So, all these muscles, they take origin from the ischial tuberosity. They should be inserted into one of the bone of the leg. They should be inserted into one of the bone of the leg. They should be supplied by tibial component of the sciatic nerve. They should bring about flexion in the knee joint, extension in the hip joint. Okay, that will be their part as hamstring muscles. Now, what are the hamstring muscles? Strictly speaking, what are the hamstring muscles? Which are all the hamstring muscles? Long end of the biceps femoris is from hamstring muscle. So, identify the thigh structure specifically, or identify the thigh structure. If I ask this one, you cannot write biceps femoris. You have to write long end of the biceps femoris. And because there is short head here, this is the short head of the biceps femoris. Short head of the biceps femoris. This is the short head. Okay, they unite at an acute angle below. So this is the long head, which is supplied by the tibial component of the sciatic nerve. The short head of the biceps femoris is supplied by common peroneal component of the sciatic nerve. Okay, then. This is the semitendon ossus. We can identify easily by looking at the lower part of the muscle where it is more tendinous. More tendinous. Okay, more tendinous. Semi-tendinous ossus. More tendinous. Semi-membrane ossus. Upper part is membrane-like. See that? Semi-membrane ossus. Upper part is membrane-like. Semi-membrane ossus. So, semi-tendinous ossus, purely hamstring muscle. Semi-tendinous ossus, purely hamstring muscle. Long head of the biceps femoris, purely hamstring muscle. Then I have to tell hamstring part of the rectar magnus. I said hamstring part of the rectar magnus because the rectar magnus consists of rectar part of the rectar compartment and hamstring part. The hamstring part takes origin from adjoining part of the rectar ischial tuberosity. Adjoining part of ischial tuberosity unites with the adductor part, runs downward, gets attached to the adductor tubercle of the femur. Adductor tubercle present in the femur. Then you may ask how it becomes hamstring part if it is attached to the adductor tubercle in the femur. It is not attached to one of the bone of the leg. It should be attached to one of the bone of the leg. In the process of evolution, the hamstring part of the adductor magnus, which was attached to the medial quantile of the tibia, form or get degenerated to form tibial collateral ligament. So tibial collateral ligament is a degenerated and divorced part of hamstring part of the adductor magnus. Tibial collateral ligament. Okay? So if you consider tibial collateral ligament as a continuation of adductor magnus, then adductor magnus also forms the hamstring muscle. Is that clear? So that's about the hamstring muscle. Okay. Then you have to see the jaws, the structures in the jaw, see the number, try to identify the different structures in the jaw, and three jaws we could not think because it is quite big. Please see these three jaws in the museum.
It's quite big, that's why we could not bring that. This height is more, in case if it falls, it will spill the formalin and which is not good.
So please see these three jars. These only three jars are
there. One jar by mistake, number got confused. We will see in the next class. Those are the things which you are supposed to see for the day. Thank you.